something. Let's say it can be upgraded, or okay, let me say it in a sloppy way first, is an equivalence of EN spaces. Okay. This is the kind of thing people will write, but it's a little maybe unclear the first time what they mean by that. What I mean is that I've specified some models of both sides that come with an action of this operat, like with an EN structure. And I've given a zigzag of maps that are both weak equivalences and strictly compatible with the structure. That's what I'm... A zigzag means, yeah, okay, let me, that's a good point. That's kind of actually, okay, it's kind of jargon in homotopy theory. So, often when you have a weak equivalence, you don't actually have a map. You just have something else that maps to both of them. And they might not have homotopy inverses, and that's what I mean. And you can have longer things. So first of all, I have to explain in what sense do both spaces have an EN structure. That's part of making sense of such a statement. And then saying there is an equivalence of EN spaces means that there's a zigzag like this, where all maps are weak equivalences, and there are given EN structures on all the spaces, and all the maps are compatible with the EN structure. No. N is equal to the dimension of the ambient space.
For equivalences of EN spaces, is it necessary to have this arbitrary length zigzag?
You can probably replace it with just one thing, but this is still good enough. If I take pi 1, all of these by this, if this dimension is at least 3, fundamental groupoid becomes symmetric monoidal. And then you have a zigzag of equivalences of those, and on that level you can invert them. So fundamental groupoid there will be equivalent to the fundamental groupoid there as a symmetric monoidal groupoid. Okay, we'll see how much I have time to say, but that's that's how this structure is relevant. Oops, I'm using this as a clock. Okay, so let me start with this thing. Why does an EN structure on a space induce a symmetric monoidal structure on its fundamental groupoid? So an EN structure is all these maps. This will be a little bit sketchy, but just give you the flavor of the argument. okay, this has to do with the homotopy type of these spaces Dn of k. Pictures are often drawn like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Here I'm just drawing the image of the embeddings. Up to homotopy, I just need to specify where the center point goes, because like the radius is some continuous parameter. So this is in fact homotopy equivalent to just injective maps, 1 up to k into Dn. Also known as the configuration space, the ordered configuration space of Dn. The only way n bigger than or equal to 3 is used is that this is simply connected. Like Dn of 2 is the space of up to homotopy is what? N minus 1 sphere. So if n is at least 3, then that's simply connected. Yes, thank you. Important point. Conf K of Dn, yes. Interior. So this is simply connected. Now I just take fundamental groupoid of this thing. This goes then to fundamental groupoid of X cross fundamental groupoid of X into fundamental groupoid of X. So on the object level, for each point in Dn of K, I get a functor of fundamental groupoids. And on the morphism level, for each path, homotopy class of path, I get a natural transformation. That's what the morphisms are here. So I get a functor like this. Well, now I just start, what am I looking for? Symmetric monoidal structure here is, well, in particular, there should be some monoidal product. So that's something you have to pick once and for all. Pick an M in, I mean, in this translation, dn of 2, which is also the objects of pi 1 of dn of 2. Under this functor, call it star, there's one of them for each k. This goes to, I don't know, we call it M again. Maybe mu, oh, just call it M. From pi 1 of x cross pi 1 of x to pi 1 of x. And then use that as the monoidal structure. Let me say maybe one more thing. Where does the associator come from? let me say that right. M circle 1 M and M circle 2 M. M takes two inputs. I could take the output of M and plug it into either the first or the second entry of itself. That gives 2 points in Dn of 3 that I can regard as objects in the fundamental groupoid of Dn of 3. Well, the space is simply connected, so any two objects are canonically isomorphic. There's a unique isomorphism between them. Then take that unique isomorphism. That's a morphism if in Dn of 3. It goes to a natural transformation of functors. And use that as the associator. And so on. Unique iso M circle 1 M M circle 2 M in fundamental groupoid of Dn of K. And this operation goes to a natural transformation of functors between pi 1 of x 3 times to pi 1 of x. And then use that as associator. whenever you have to check any axioms like the pentagon axiom, you're checking that two natural transformations are equal. That translates to checking that two morphisms here are equal, but since this is a simply connected space, then all morphisms between the same two objects are automatically equal. So one, the only thing that takes a while is to write out all the things you have to check. Everything is kind of obviously works once you've written them. Okay, but you have to make this choice. So that maybe sounds a little non-canonical, but that's how monoidal structures are. Like if you check the disjoint union of two sets, you also have to choose a way of doing that. And nobody ever emphasizes that, but maybe you implement it by saying zero cross one set, then one cross the other set. Someone else does something else. The reason we don't talk about that is because two choices are canonically isomorphic, and the same is true here. If I pick a different M, I get canonically isomorphic symmetric monoidal structures. equivalent at least. Okay, enough about that. So that was this thing. How do I get EN structures on these two spaces? Let's start with the right-hand side. This is kind of also historically where operands came from. iterated loop spaces. If I have an embedding of open manifolds, I can get a map in the other direction of one-point compactifications. The one-point compactification here is Sn. So I want to think of that as Dn interior, union infinity, one-point compactification. If you have something in the image, you just take the inverse. Otherwise, you just send it to infinity. And that's continuous. And the one-point compactification here is the wedge product of k copies of Sn. The standard notation is. Let me temporarily call it J alpha star or something, just to, because it goes the other way. So if I now have a pointed space, X or something, I can take mapping space out of this.
I didn't understand at all
what this is. Oh, so this sends, if I have a, okay, so I have an X here. It goes to either J inverse of X in 1 up to K cross Dn interior. I regard this as the one-point compactification of that. I either take J inverse if that makes sense, otherwise I take infinity if X is an image of J. Then you have to check it's continuous, but if you sort of stop being in the image, it must mean you get further and further, closer and closer to infinity. So now if, I don't know, Y is any pointed space, and X is the n-fold loop space of Y, which means based maps from Sn to Y. This, by the way, is a based map. Then pre-composition with this J star gives a map from based maps out of this. So based maps. Into Y. Based maps is by definition the loop space, n for loop space. So this was X. Wedge is like the coproduct in base spaces, so this is just X to the N, no, X to the K. So for each point in Dn of, this was a point in Dn of K, I've gotten a map from X to the K back to X. And that's what I need for the data for an EN structure on X. DN of K to map X to the K X. This was the K space in the endomorphism operator. And composition goes to composition and so on. So this is in fact an EN structure that's canonically associated to writing X as the n-fold loop space. So we have that here because the N in this statement was precisely the dimension of V. And I remind you, by loops V of anything, this was pointed maps out of SV, where SV means the one-point compactification of V. So if V is Rn, you one-point compactify all of Rn or just the unit disk, of course, is homeomorphic. So that's the En structure here. What about here? So En structure on B, C, D, V, if N is the dimension of V. Okay, maybe I shouldn't have written it this way. Maybe I should have said given a specified isomorphism to Rn. Maybe that's a better statement because it's going to depend on that. Anyway, the idea is very simple. And it almost works, and then there's one thing that doesn't work, and then there's an obvious fix to that. So I'm supposed to given a point in dn of k, which is an embedding like this. I'm supposed to give a map from this space, k times, back to this space. Well, okay, let's pick once and for all, not this thing, but pick a diffeomorphism from V to the interior of the N disk. So that's possible on that assumption. Then I can think of this as 1, comma, up to k cross V, and this as V. This is now an embedding of smooth manifolds. Maybe I kind of want to think of it as the same as this one, but strictly speaking, it's okay. Just change the names. Then there's an obvious functor from C D V cross C D V. CDV functor. CDV was the cobordism category, whose objects are D minus one dimensional closed submanifolds of V, and morphisms are cobordisms inside V across an interval of some length that you specify. So maybe I can draw this case, D being one and V being R. The objects then are zero manifolds inside R, also known as finite subsets, and morphisms are cobordisms, and then there was some fine print about them being kind of product. So this would be a morphism from 3 points to 3 points. So this was a picture of 0, comma t cross v, and we remember this positive number in order to have composition be strictly associative. We compose by just sticking these next to each other. It's a non-unital category. If I have an embedding of k copies of v back into v, I just apply that to if I have k either objects or morphisms. So the objects are just d minus one dimensional submanifolds of B. So M1 up to MK, where MI sits inside V is a d minus one dimensional submanifold. Just send this to the ith copy I apply, kind of the ith copy of V. So this would go to the union of J of I comma MI. And these are disjoint, so this union is still a manifold. That's what you do on objects, and on morphisms you do the corresponding thing. Just cross with this interval. And that's a functor. And it's continuous on morphism. spaces, so I can take B of it. B of, I think the notes I again call this J star. B of J star goes from B, C, D, V to the K back to B, C, D, V. I have one of those for each point J in the space. So that's the data I need to give an EN structure. The one little problem is that is that this is not a continuous function of J. because this was a topologically enriched category that has a set of objects. And if I wiggle this J a little bit, okay, the image looks like it wiggles a little bit, but the objects have the discrete topology, like, like N0 CDV has the discrete topology. So this is not quite continuous. Then you fix that by topologizing the objects. You no longer have a topologically enriched category. You have what's called a category internal to topological spaces, where you have a space of objects, and source and target maps are continuous, so on. So in the notes, I used something that looks, I mean, intentionally, it's going to look almost the same, because they're meant to be kind of two instances of the same, I don't know, platonic idea, of a cobordism category. Here was a topologically enriched category with a discrete set of objects. Here's what's sometimes called a topological category, or a category internal to spaces that has a space of objects. Topologized in a similar way, where objects can kind of move continuously. And if you use that one instead, then this idea works. And you can also prove that if you take B of this, you get a weak equivalence. So this is a weak equivalence, and this has this has the EN structure. Using precisely this idea. This was kind of the only reason. The objects are the only reason for this discontinuity.
Is the reason that's a weak equivalence because you can wiggle the object by cobordism?
Yes, kind of. If you have a continuous, you have a path in the object space over there, like why does that lift to a path? You just take a morphism instead, use that as a simplex. Yeah, exactly. I mean, the actual proof is there's some general fact about simplacial spaces. If you take the zero simplices and make them discrete, it's called the Bausfield-Friedlander theorem. That's probably the cleanest way to write an actual proof, but but that's the idea. Okay, so now, oh, I erased that. I've explained why both sides in this equivalence, at least if your handwriting is ugly enough that you can't tell the difference, how to give both of them I mean, they have EN structures, but I mean given the ones I just explained. then it's a theorem. this weak equivalence that was, as I said, the direct limit where V kind of goes to infinity, it was first proved by myself and Ulrike Tillman and Eve Madsen and Michael Weiss. then there was a finite dimensional version. The proof there does not talk about EN structures or anything. then a guy, Nguyen, prove that you can realize this as in the direct limit is compatible with the operat structure, and then Chris Jarmapries 2 years ago proved that you can realize this weak equivalence by can be realized by zigzag. The reference is in the notes. By zigzag of EN maps. So therefore that implies, if you take fundamental groupoid, it implies an equivalence of symmetric monoidal groupoids. Where on this side you have something you might be interested in. The universal groupoid comes with a map from the cobordism category. And on this side you have something homotopy theoretic, where the symmetric monoidal structure just comes from writing this as an info loop space of something else. So that's where I wanted to end. So. If d equals 2 and v is r infinity?
R3.
R3, what it says. Oh, other than just the statement, I don't know that it says something.
No, if I mean like, for example, can you calculate that?
Oh, can I calculate it? So in that case, I should also have said that there are versions with orientation and so on, but you would first calculate the homotopy type, I suppose. You would have loops 3 of some space, which has to do with, if V is R3, then this is R4. Then you have the Grassmannian of two planes in R4. And then you take the Thom space of the perpendicular bundle of that. Then you take the threefold loop space of that. And if you're interested in the fundamental groupoid here, you're interested in pi 3 and pi 4 of this space. So you could, I mean, I'm sure you could do that with sufficient motivation.
What I'm confused about is it looks like, it's, you know, this is about the circles in R3.
Surfaces in R3. Surfaces in R3.
Well, I thought if V equals...
Okay, objects are, yes, you're right.
So
yep.
But circles in R3 are like knots, and you're asking for embedded cobordisms.
Yep, in R4. right, pi zero of the kind of groupoid completion, yeah. Yeah, knots up to whatever that's called. It's not concordance because that means...
Not because you're enjoying that
itself. It's like a surface of any genus and could be non-orientable, but yeah. Yeah, so it's not concordance that it answers. It's like cobordism of something that's not necessarily a cylinder.